At the weekend, Beyoncé urged African Americans in the United States to take part in the presidential election this year. She said, "To vote like our life depends on it, because it does." She also praised the Black Lives Matter protests, saying, "I'm encouraging you to continue to take action, continue to change and dismantle a racist and unequal system." She was speaking at the BET Awards. It stands for Black Entertainment Television. And she was far from the only artist there to make strong statements about the aftermath of George Floyd's death. Mark Mardell's been looking at how much black music, black culture, has changed politics in America now and in the past.
See, everyone gets a game piece, but what does yours say? Well, mine says, I'm a black man born in America.
You gotta be the voice for the black people in your household, and it has to start today.
If you like black culture, if you have black friends, then this is your fight too.
What I've seen is something we haven't seen in this country.
Terence Blanchard has written the score for 17 of Spike Lee's movies and is a trumpeter of renown. He says this is a moment for optimism, or at least faith.
Young people from all different walks of life out there fighting for what's right. Nobody's born racist, man, it's something you learn. Fighting for what's just. At the same time, throughout every industry here, people are being called out for their biases. We've seen it in sports, we've seen it in merchandising, and we've seen it all over the place. So let's hope we see it in legislation. That's where I think it should really resonate and really make a difference.
But we have been here before. This is hardly the first time change has been in the air. 1963, the March on Washington. At the height of the civil rights movement, a demand for an end to segregation and discrimination, and one of the most powerful speeches the world has ever heard.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
And some of the most powerful music, too, bringing protesters black and white together. 22-year-old Bob Dylan was on the platform. But it was Peter, Paul and Mary who sang the Dylan song the protest movement had made its own. The crowd linked together, swaying, hands held aloft. Someone not there that day was struck by the power of that song, Sam Cooke. Sam Cooke was inspired. He said, "From now on, it's not going to be about how pretty the voice is. It's going to be about believing the voice is telling the truth." Full of admiration, but stung, perhaps, that this anthem was written by a white folk singer. He was about to write one of his own, which has stood the test of time. I was born by the river. Among the many artists who've covered Change Is Gonna Come is Bettye Lavette. And she knew Sam Cooke back in the day. Well, knew is stretching it a bit. She was 18 months old, crawling round while a bunch of musicians had a good time.
Well, my family sold corn liquor in Western Michigan in the 40s, and that was when Sam first joined the Soul Stirrers, and even before that, the Blind Boys of Mississippi and all those people had always come to our house. My mother made fish sandwiches, chicken sandwiches, and they had the liquor. And of course, in 1946, if you wanted a drink, you couldn't just drop into a bar if you were black.
I said, I mean it.
A bunch of entertainers drunk, they're gonna sing.
Sam Cooke was welcome at Bettye's parents' joint. Not so when he arrived at a motel in Shreveport, Louisiana.
Wonderful.
He and his band had made reservations. When they arrived, the desk clerk took one look at them and said, "No vacancies." Wonderful. He protested. His wife told him to quieten down. "They'll kill you." "Wonderful. They ain't gonna kill me because I'm Sam Cooke." His wife replied, "No, to them, you're just another, well, you know." They didn't kill him, but they did arrest him. It fueled his determination to write a song of hope.
I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know
if you was white. There, of course, had been plenty of black musicians earlier in the 20th century singing about their situation.
Oh, brother,
get back, get back.
The name of this tune is Mississippi Goddamn.
But in many ways, it was a conversation within a community about what they all knew to be true, sold as race records.
And I mean every word of it.
Perhaps the first crossover song of protest was the still chilling song Billie Holiday used to finish her set with.
The lunch trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root.
Bettye has done a version of that for her new album.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze.
Civil rights songs, like the movement, was a conversation between the races, between generations, with a shared political ambition for a change that was going to come. For Bettye, the civil rights movement seemed quite remote. The bias, the racism, was simply a fact of life.
Goodness, it seemed quite normal. That's the thing about it. That was what had happened the day before and the day before that. And it seemed even more normal to my mother than it did to me. She was born and raised on a plantation in Louisiana. Everything seemed absolutely fine to her.
But it wasn't fine. The civil rights marches won a formal legal end to all forms of segregation in 1968. But that's a far cry from equality.
I was just growing up. I mean, I was just trying to grow up in show business. But I wasn't that involved in the civil rights movement. It mostly stemmed from churches. In 1969, I had a record called He Made a Woman Out of Me. It was in Cash Box and Billboard. It made every black radio station in the country. And Bobby Gentry had it out about 6 months after mine came out. Hers, of course, was played on every white station in the country.
When Joe had to come up the river, y'all, Lord made a woman out of me. Yes, he did.
Now, if I'd had that airplay to add to my existing airplay, mine would have been number one. But a whole three-fourths of the country never heard mine. It was written for me.
But the change was coming.
I saw some of the first black millionaires, something my mother had never seen. But I came up in Detroit and watched Berry Gordy and Smokey Robinson become millionaires. So until then, I had never seen anyone who looked like me with $1 million.
The music of the civil rights era did bring people together, but has a more recent revolution in music won new hearts and minds.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping, no.
All's my life I has to fight. All's my life I, hard times like yeah. Now here we come, all our bones here. Follow my parade, my parade.
It's not just that black artists from Beyonce to Kendrick Lamar are part of the American mainstream culture now. It's that their very political concerns are central.
I want to dedicate this award to all of my brothers out there, all of my sisters out there marching and fighting for change.
Surely that must have an impact on a young white audience. Terence Blanchard is not convinced how deep this goes. He wrote the score for Black Klansman, Malcolm X, and Spike Lee's latest film, The Five Bloods. And sitting alongside his music in the film, this song. Marvin Gaye's What's Going On was written after one of the Four Tops told the story of seeing, from his tour bus, anti-war protesters attacked by police. Terence says, people hear the melody of our plight without knowing what the words mean for us. And yeah, that is a metaphor.
Mother, 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 there's far too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of us dying. Picket signs, you know, don't punish me with brutality. I mean, think about it. Those words are powerful. And the sad part about it, not only are they powerful, but they're still relevant. I was just on a Zoom call a couple of days ago with a friend of mine who's a film executive, and he was just talking about the movie. And he's a little older than me, and he goes, man, I've been loving that song for years, and I've danced to it. But man, when I watched the movie, I had the subtitles on, and it hit me what the words really meant. And I had to tell him, I said, look, dude, you're describing exactly what I've been talking about. And he's a well-meaning dude, guy with a good heart, not a malicious bone in his body. But it's conditioning. It's the way you're brought up. It's hard to fight that. But that's where the battle lies, at the core of your belief system. You know, no matter how well-meaning they are, when they leave any protest, they go home to a situation that has none of that oppression. It's just the reality. Those protesters will leave a protest and be on the highway and won't have to worry about the police misjudging them.
I'm a young black man.
It's such an interesting thing to think that I could walk the streets and be mistaken for somebody who's up to no good.
Doing all that I can.
I could be mistaken for somebody who has no relation to me whatsoever.
To stay.
But the reverse is not true.
Oh, but when I look around,
I've watched videos of young white men defying police orders, not being shot.
Every day.
So that's the reality. That's what's going on. It's a hard thing to describe. When people saw George Floyd die on camera and watched this cop seem to enjoy the entire process, it was the equivalent of a modern-day lynching. For well-meaning people, it finally hit them in a way that us talking about it could never have.
I was born.
I said earlier that Bettye Lavette had covered that song. Actually, she sang it at President Obama's inauguration, a moment of triumph.
It was quite a thing, the biggest thing that's ever happened to me. 800 million people were looking at me. Probably the most exciting thing I've ever done in my entire career.
So has change come?
Oh, things will certainly change. We just had a black president. But the systemic racism that goes on here have not changed. People do not look at that systemic thing. They look at you being beaten or lynched, but they don't look at this thing that all blacks are born and raised with, that's never even taught them. The subservience now is working on automatic pilot.
But without overdoing it, is music, culture, part of the process? Terence Blanchard.
I do think that music has the possibility of changing hearts and minds. But that is nowhere near as powerful as seeing a man call for his dead mother, a grown man, call for his dead mother while he lay dying in the streets of Minneapolis.
Bettye Lavette believes more change is going to come.
Well, I don't know what it's going to be, too, but it's definitely moving, and it looks different this time than it's ever looked before.
But now I think I'm able to carry.
And then I looked on TV the other day and saw in Des Moines, Iowa, all these whites with the five blacks that live there marching with Black Lives Matter t-shirts on. And I just broke down and cried. My husband said, I thought that would make you happy. I said, I am happy. That's why I'm crying.
Bettye Lavette talking to Mark Mardell.